Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
My name is Jacqueline Beauchere, and I'm the Chief Online Safety Officer here at Microsoft. I'd like to welcome you all on behalf of the MSR Visiting Speaker Series. Just a brief introduction about Katie Davis. She is an assistant professor at the University of Washington Information School, where she studies the role of digital media in adolescents' academic, social, and moral lives. She also serves as an advisory board member for MTV's digital abuse campaign, A Thin Line. She holds two master's degrees and a doctorate in human development and education from the Harvard Graduate School of Education. Prior to joining the UW iSchool, Katie worked with Dr. Howard Gardner and colleagues at Harvard's Project Zero, where she was a member of the Good Play Project and the Developing Minds and Digital Media Project research teams. My colleagues and I in Trustworthy Computing met with Katie a few months ago, where she came to campus to talk to us about online bullying and other online safety topics. We learned at the time that Katie is the only professor in the U.S. that has a program dedicated to digital youth. Personally, I found the app generation to be really insightful, and I loved what I would call the connecting generations theme that pervades the book. Katie's co-author, if you will, is the older adult, and Katie is his generational junior. And then there's a time for Katie's sister to be interviewed as well, who is a teen at the time of the writing in the book. And then there's even a little surprise at the end where yet another generation is brought into the dialogue. So without further ado, Katie Davis. Thank you.
Hi, good afternoon, and thank you so much for choosing me over the beautiful sun outside, at least for the time being. So this book represents a synthesis of research that I've been conducting with Howard Gardner and my colleagues since 2007 at the Harvard Graduate School of Education. And for the last several years, Howard and I have been researching the role that digital media technologies play in various aspects of young people's lives. But really, the seeds for the book were planted for me several years before that in my fourth grade classroom. So while I was a teacher, a fourth grade teacher in the early to mid 2000s, and during that time, technology was becoming increasingly central to young people's lives, both inside and outside of school. And at that time, my sister Molly, who figures prominently in the book, was 8 years old, and I could just tell that she was growing up in a much different way than I was. And from my view as a teacher and a considerably older sister, it was clear to me that this trend was only going to continue, and it was going to get bigger, and that there were all sorts of really exciting and important implications involved with respect to how young people learn and how they communicate with other people, and really how they form a sense of who they are in the world. So I was really fortunate that when I went to Harvard as a doctoral student, Howard was just beginning to start to ask similar questions. And we started off particularly exploring the moral and ethical dimensions of what kids were doing online. So those tricky, thorny situations that they encounter related to their privacy and ownership and authorship and participation in different communities. But then we started to broaden our focus, and we started to explore other aspects of youth development, such as their identity development, their social development, and also their creative expression. And so, as Jacqueline mentioned, we created a project called the Developing Minds in Digital Media Project. And really, it sought to pose a very big question. How are today's young people different from young people who grew up in a pre-digital era? And we began to interview adults who had worked with kids for at least two decades, and we just asked them, what have you noticed over the time that you've been teaching? We also looked at what young people had been producing creatively over that 20-year period, and we talked to young people. We interviewed and surveyed over 2,000 young people in the U.S. And during the course of our research, we came to an important realization. Whereas earlier generations have typically been defined by political or economic events. So if you think about the World Wars, the Great Depression, the Civil Rights Movement, this generation of young people is defined more and actually defines itself more by the technologies that they use. And what was most telling was that their desire to have everything very quickly, very efficiently, very well packaged, no mess, no fuss. Now, when we started the research in 2007, apps weren't really part of the cultural zeitgeist the way they are now. But as the iPhone was introduced and the slogan, "there's an app for that," became a common saying, we started to realize that actually apps served as a fitting metaphor for what we were observing in our research. So in the book and in my talk today, I'll be kind of going in and out from speaking about apps sort of literally, and then also speaking about them metaphorically in terms of our relationship to technology. So that's why we called the book The App Generation. Really, it's because it served as a fitting metaphor for what we were seeing. So let's unpack that a little bit. Let's consider the features of an app. So think about what, as we've come to know it today, what an app is. So basically, it's a software application commonly stored on your phone or your tablet. I'm sure most of you are holding a phone right now with a bunch of apps. And it allows you to perform a very discrete task, whether it's searching for a nearby coffee shop, sharing pictures on Instagram, or looking up the name of that actor in the TV show that you're watching. Apps let you do all of these things very quickly and on demand. You could think of them as shortcuts. They take you straight to what you're looking for. There's no need to perform a web search. Now, apps are plentiful and they span a wide variety of categories. In the Apple Store alone, they have over 1 million apps available for downloads in all sorts of categories, like lifestyle and games and finance and music and productivity. I understand there may not be quite as many apps available in the Windows Store, but there's still a variety. Now, apps are plentiful, but they're not infinite. And importantly, the things that you can do with any given app are going to be highly constrained by the design and coding decisions that were made by the app developer. And lastly, one of the key signifiers of an app is that visual icon that's associated with it. So consider the Facebook F or the Twitter bird or the Amazon shopping cart. All of these logos are very highly evocative, and they illustrate the fact that apps are fundamentally tied up in their external packaging and visual representation. So in the book, we argue that young people growing up today are not just immersed in apps. So speaking metaphorically here, it's almost as if they've come to see the world as a collection of apps, their lives as a string of ordered apps. And this is perhaps not surprising when there are apps and technology generally for just about any activity that you can think of, setting personal goals, communicating with other people, creating art. And in the book, we introduce the idea of an app mentality that many of today's young people seem to exhibit. The app mentality suggests that whatever human beings might desire or might question should be answered and provided by apps. And if the wanted app doesn't exist, well then, one should be devised right away. If no app can be imagined or created to fulfill that desire, well then maybe that desire didn't matter to begin with, or maybe it shouldn't matter. So the big question is this app mentality good or is it bad? Now, a world permeated by apps is many ways a terrific one. I love my apps, I don't know about you, and I use them to do a ton of things, to make plans with friends, to find my way around in an unfamiliar location, to listen to music, to wake me up in the morning, to put me to bed at night. Apps are great if they can take care of these ordinary things, and then free us up to pursue more important matters. They're a great way to keep us connected to our friends and our family. They're even a great way to introduce us to new experiences. It's our contention that when apps are used in this way, as entry points or as jumping off points into new experiences, they're app enabling. But there's a less optimistic view of apps. There's a danger that we become overly dependent on apps for the answers, for social connection, for our sense of ourselves. There's a danger that we look to apps before we look inside of ourselves. And if this happens, if we start to see more of our apps than ourselves and our experiences and our actions and our self-expressions, it's our argument that we have become app-dependent. So in our research with our colleagues, Howard and I have considered this tension between app-enabling on the one hand and app-dependence on the other within three spheres of experience that are particularly salient for young people. That's their sense of personal identity, their intimate relationships with other people, and also the way they exercise their creative and imaginative powers. So we call these the three I's of identity, intimacy, and imagination, and they really form the focus of our book. Now, to explore how today's app generation experiences each of these three I's, we collected data, as I mentioned earlier, from a wide variety of sources. So we started with in-depth interviews with veteran teachers. We then conducted 7 focus groups with educators who had been teaching both inside of schools and outside of schools, as well as in other areas. We interviewed therapists and religious leaders. And my personal favorite focus group was with camp directors, because at the end, there was one of the camp directors who took out his banjo and led us in song, and that was really fun. We also looked at what young people had been producing over the last 20 years, from 1990 to 2011. We looked at both their visual art and their creative writing. And then we talked to kids. We talked to over 2,000 young people. And in the book, we kind of triangulate all this research that we conducted, as well as research from other scholars, to explore how the app mentality manifests in each of the three areas of identity, intimacy, and imagination. So let's take a look at the first I, identity. So as I've noted, apps are very much tied up in their external representation, that visual icon that evokes a particular brand. And it appears that the identities of today's young people are increasingly externally packaged. That is, they're developed and put forth so that they convey a certain desirable image of themselves to a particular audience, and it may not be adults. And that audience may be real or imagined. Now, this identity is not unlike the branded icon of an app. And apps and the social media platforms that apps give rise to and provide access to seem to encourage this emphasis on personal packaging and branding. So if you think about in the emergence in recent years of constant status updates and selfies and profile likes, these are all kind of symptoms of this trend towards the packaged self. Now, one effect of this packaging, the emphasis on performing to an external audience, is that focus on the inner life, that internal sense of self, may be minimized somewhat. So including reflection on one's values and goals and dreams. Now, of course, a really big part of forming one's identity is doing so in a social context. But there's also a part of forming one's identity that requires some inner and quiet reflection on what matters to you. So on a more distinctly positive note, today's youth have opportunities to explore a wider variety of identities in the vast array of communities that they have access to online. So whether those communities are related to music or fan culture, civic engagement, or gaming. And such identity exploration is really an important part of youth development. So in many ways, this is a great opportunity. And we saw a lot of that in our research. And it also, as well, appears that youth are more accepting and welcoming of a wider variety of identities than other people, whether related to race or sexual orientation or personal interests. And it seems reasonable to suspect that the internet and social media platforms have played an important role here, so helping to connect youth to people across geographic and cultural boundaries. In the process, expanding their knowledge and understanding of people who are different from them. So with respect to intimacy, we found that youth are certainly always connected, both to their friends and their parents. So first, let's consider parents. You don't often think of, oh, parents and teens, they're always hanging out. But really, we find in our research that today's youth are connected to a greater degree and also for a longer time to their parents. And in many ways, this is a really positive thing. It's a positive development. Parents and their children seem to be closer than ever, and that's great. But the question is, how much connection is too much, especially during adolescence and then in the college years during emerging adulthood, when an important developmental task, at least in Western societies, is to gain a sense of autonomy and identity that is distinct from one's parents. So consider one of the studies we came across in our research done by researchers out of Middlebury College, and they found that college kids are on average in contact with their parents over 13 times per week. And I don't know about you, but when I was in college, I maybe called home once a week, but that was about it. But, you know, these 13 times a week is quite extraordinary, I think, and it's, you know, very small, quick communications, usually text or phone, just checking in about their day, asking for advice about what course they should take or things like that, what they should wear, eat for breakfast. In our own research, we were struck by this one anecdote in the camp director focus group, where one of the camp directors told us, while the other camp directors were nodding in recognition, that parents often send their children to camp with two cell phones, one to turn over to camp personnel at the start of camp, and the other one to hide so that they can communicate with their parents. And again, you know, I went to camp a couple times and there was no connection at all to my parents. So with respect to friends, digital media allow youth to stay in constant communication with their friends. But constant communication doesn't always translate into deep communication. And it's hard. It's hard to stay deeply connected with any one person when you're trying to keep up with hundreds or even thousands of friends and followers across multiple social media platforms, while at the same time listening to music and doing your homework and maybe watching a TV show on Netflix or Hulu. And related to this, we've witnessed a certain reluctance in young people to show vulnerability in their relationships. After all, it's far easier to share personal feelings at arm's length and through a screen rather than by looking at someone and confronting them face to face. Now, consider the connection to apps here. As I've noted, apps are ultimately shortcuts. And when it comes to relationships, shortcuts can make interacting with others very quick, very easy, and also less risky because, again, you don't have to confront someone. And if the conversation gets a little too personal, a little too uncomfortable, you can just close out the app and you're done. Now, if these shortcuts are used in moderation and to augment rather than replace existing relationships, there's a lot of ways where they can support meaningful relationships. And we saw a lot of evidence of young people using technology to really support and promote and develop their social relationships. But if they're used to replace rather than augment, or if they start to get in the way of sustained deep communication, then apps may facilitate superficial ties and lead to relationships that are more transactional than transformational. So consider this dating app, Tinder. Who here is familiar with this app? Okay, many of you, okay. Much more than at the Seattle Town Hall. So basically, Tinder, for the uninitiated, it's basically a stripped-down dating app, and it just shows you pictures and very basic facts about the people who are in your immediate area. So basically, what you do is this picture kind of shows is you swipe through the pictures, and if you find someone attractive, then you swipe right. If you don't, too bad for them, you swipe left. And then if two people both swipe right, then there's a match, and who knows what will go on after that. Now, of course, there's nothing to say that this app couldn't lead to a meaningful in-person relationship like other dating apps have. But anecdotal evidence that I've heard from young people suggests that many of them are using it primarily as a way to facilitate casual hookups. So in other words, purely transactional one-time interactions. And apparently it was actually quite popular among the American athletes this year in the Olympic Village. So lastly, imagination. Now, a sizable portion of the app ecology is devoted to supporting artistic production. So there are apps for just about any genre you can imagine to create something, like painting, drawing, video editing, filmmaking, music composition, pretty much anything you can think of. And digital media really have opened up new avenues for youth to express themselves creatively. And importantly, these avenues are very quick, they're easy, and they're cheap, cheaper than they ever have been. Yet it's important to consider the fact that the app developers, as I said before, they're going to constrain the range of actions you can do with any given artistic app. And so that's going to constrain the artistic expression in specific ways. So, for instance, if you're using a painting app, your color palette is going to be limited to the hues that the designer programmed into the app. And if you're using a music composition app, your tonal range is similarly going to be limited. Now, of course, enterprising and sophisticated users can create their own workarounds and they can break free from the constraints of the underlying code. But realistically, most people are going to probably work within the parameters of the original app. Now, it may be true that creativity loves constraints. Still, it's worth asking, how much constraint is too much? And how do these digital boundaries affect the creative process? So which is it? I've kind of offered two scenarios. Is technology supporting, enhancing young people's creativity, or is it undermining their creativity? So we actually wanted to investigate that question by looking directly at what young people had been producing creatively over the course of the last 20 years. And we looked in two particular domains, visual art and creative writing. And here I'll go into just a little bit more detail about our methods and some of our key findings. We drew our visual art sample from a teen literary and art magazine that has been published since 1989 and is still being published, several editions every year. And we developed a detailed coding scheme with 18 separate codes. And to help us develop this coding scheme, we had two master students at Harvard in the Arts and Education program who had fine arts degrees. So they really knew about this domain and the appropriate codes to create. And in total, we coded over 350 works of art, from half from the early 1990s and then half from the more recent years in 2010 and 2011. And here's just a very small sample of some of the art that we got to look at. And it was a lot of fun, this part of the research, just seeing all the different artwork that kids had created over the last 20 years. And our coding scheme. Now, I'm not going to go through all the codes at all, just share with you some of the key findings from the codes that are highlighted in orange. So let's start with background. So one of the things, and basically one of the things we did was we took each component of the artistic process. And so we looked and we zoomed in and analyzed any changes. So first, when we were looking at background, we looked and categorized pieces to see how fully rendered was the background. Was the figure on just a blank background, or was there something going on in the background? And what we found was in the earlier pieces in the early 1990s, most of them tended to be on blank or just partially rendered backgrounds. Whereas you can see in the late pieces, this is just one example, the background tended to be more filled out and just more going on generally. We looked at composition. So we looked at how the figures were positioned in the visual plane. Were they straight on, centered? Were they off-centered? Things like that. And what we found was in the earlier pieces, they tended more or less to be centered, whereas the more recent pieces tended to be slightly off-center and display stylized cropping. And lastly, we looked at medium, and we had a bunch of different subcodes for this, a lot of different types of media, and we generally categorized them into two big categories, the more traditional media like pen and ink and drawing and painting, and then the more non-traditional media such as collage or digital art or found objects. And what we found, perhaps not surprisingly, there was more non-traditional media used in the more recent pieces, but there was a particular decline in the use of pen and ink. There were, I would say, I think over 50% of the earlier pieces tended to be pen and ink, whereas the more recent pieces, very few were. There was much more mixed media, found objects, and collage. So, creative writing, what did we find here? So, when we wanted to look at creative writing, we looked at two data sets that we compiled that were, and one of the hard things about this research was just finding complete data sets over the course of the last 20 years. So we kind of had to look all across the country for that. We were able to find bodies of work from middle school kids and high school kids from the early 1990s through present day. And again, we had a very extensive coding scheme, and I won't go through it. Just touch on some key findings from the orange highlighted codes. And again, here, our coding scheme was developed based on conventions in writing. We were looking both at the structure of the writing and also the content, because we were interested to see if themes of media, for instance, came up in their writing. So again, I'll share with you some key findings. First, one of our big codes was coding for genre. Were they writing a historical fiction piece? Were they writing an epistle or a fantasy piece or an absurdist piece? We categorized each story according to their genre. And what we found is in the earlier pieces, they tended to be a little bit out there. And the earlier pieces from, this is the early 1990s, they tended to have magical elements, surrealist elements, absurdist themes, whereas the more recent pieces tended to kind of stick close to home. They were more mundane, daily experience type themes. So just to give you a flavor of the earlier 1990s pieces, one of the stories that was very vivid for me when I read it was just a short kind of vignette of the protagonist who went to see his therapist, who happened to be a crab, and they had a very strange conversation. But at the end of it, the protagonist grabbed his crab therapist with a pair of tongs and took him home to boil him. So very kind of just out there, you know, weird. And we didn't see that type of thing in the more recent pieces. Another story I remember. There's a city, and one day everybody in the city wakes up, and there's this huge mirror dome over the city that's exposing the corruption and the crime of the city. So it's just these kind of strange, you know, our initial reaction were, gosh, these earlier pieces are just a little weird and out there and quirky. Whereas the more recent pieces were kind of, they kind of felt more like, you know, this is what I did today type of thing. We also looked at structure, so how they progressed in time, these stories. And the more recent pieces were tended, kind of related to the genre, they tended to follow a more chronological order. So this happened, then this happened, then this happened. The early 1990s pieces, they tended to jump around all over the place in time. So present, past, future, and some of them didn't have any sort of linear narrative at all. It was just kind of a sketch of something. We also looked at voice, because voice is something that you can look at to see how traditional or conventional a piece is. And so the earlier pieces tended to be more in the first and second person voice, whereas the more recent pieces were in the third person, and that tends to be more conventional. And then we also looked at language, because there's a lot of talk about these days about, you know, net speak, and is that affecting how kids are writing and expressing themselves? And we did find a difference in how young people use words and language from the early 1990s to the more recent times. But we didn't find any examples of net speak, but it was definitely more informal language in the more recent pieces. And it was, you know, a lot more slang and cursing and even made up words. So the bottom line, as Marshall McLuhan would say, the medium really does matter with respect to how creativity has changed in young people over the last 20 years. So with respect to visual art, we actually see increasing complexity and less conventionality. And in the creative writing, it's kind of an opposite trend almost. We see less experimentation and almost a greater adherence to the everyday and the mundane. So in short, we see more graphic and less literary imagination in our sample of teens. Now, if we think about this in terms of the role of digital media, think about considering art in particular. So there's probably two things we think are going on. Now, of course, we can't draw any direct connection. But if you think about the first big big thing that digital media provide is just new tools for production. And as I said before, the tools are easy to come by, they're cheap, and they just open up a really wide range of avenues for creative expression. So that's probably something to do with what's going on with the visual art. The other thing that we see is that the internet has just expanded our access to sources of inspiration from other people, and we can see what other people have created, people like us and people, you know, different from us, and get inspiration, draw inspiration from them. Now, with respect to writing, that's a little bit more complicated. It's hard to tell. There's a lot of talk about maybe are kids reading less, are they writing less? And it's hard to tell, I think, if they're actually writing less. But I think it's probably safe to say that the type of writing that many of them are doing online is often different. And it's often very quick, it's very fleeting, it's casual, and it's very much tied to the everyday and mundane. It's also worth noting, now, of course, I would be remiss not to say this as an educator, having done this research in an education school, that there's a really big trend that's also taken place over the last 20 years in our schools. And that's the trend towards an increased focus on standardized testing, and really teaching to the test and teaching kids to craft that perfect 5-paragraph essay. And we think that that's probably also got something to do with the changes that we've seen in creative writing. So I just want to say one more thing about creativity in a digital era. So creativity scholars, they often talk about, make a distinction between big C creativity and little C creativity. Now the former consists of the truly groundbreaking works of art, those original works that fundamentally change a domain forever. So if you think about Stravinsky's Rite of Spring, or Picasso's Les Demoiselles d'Avignon, or Martha Graham's Frontier, all of these pieces fundamentally change the domains of music and art and dance. In contrast, little C creativity is really found in the realm of the everyday. So how we approach daily problem solving, how do we adapt to the changes that come our way on a daily basis? And so through the course of our investigations, we've started to think that perhaps digital media give rise to and possibly allow more people to engage in a middle C creativity that is definitely more interesting and impressive than little C creativity. But due to the built-in software constraints and perhaps obstacles to deep engagement because of multitasking, decidedly less groundbreaking than big C creativity. Now, to be sure, there's a place for all three kinds of creativity in any society. But the types of disruptive, groundbreaking innovations that move societies forward rely particularly on big C creativity. So back to apps. We're often asked to, when we give talks, to identify apps that are enabling and apps that are dependent, that promote dependence. And the answer really is that any app can be used in more or less of a dependent or an enabling way. However, a lot of the apps that we've come across, particularly in the area of education, tend to lean towards app dependence. So if you consider this example, there's this app, Doodle Buddy. Are some people familiar with it or maybe have used it? A few of you, I see. So it's basically a drawing app. And this is, I think, a good example of how one app can actually lean towards app enabling or app dependence. It can go either way, depending on the setting. So let's look first at the app enabling scenario. So here you go. You start, open up your Doodle Buddy, and you just start with a blank canvas. And you choose the colors that you want to use or choose what implement you want to use to apply them. Now, you are constrained somewhat in those choices, but then you just start drawing and you apply and it may not be a work of art, but it's yours and it's been done in an open-ended way. Now, there, in that very same app, there's another way to use it that tilts more towards app dependence. So same app, but in a different setting, you have prefab backgrounds and prefab figures. And you just kind of select the background you want, you plop it onto your canvas. Similarly, you choose your figures and you just kind of plop it on. Eventually, you've kind of got a paint-by-numbers picture. So what can we do as educators, as parents, as designers of apps to tilt that balance toward using apps in an enabling way, and more broadly speaking, to encourage youth to live their lives in an app-enabling way and not give up their agency to their digital devices? So we suggest that the first thing is we need to model app enablement ourselves. We need to model moderation in our technology use. So adults are powerful models for kids. They're watching us. They're looking at how we are tied to our phones and our tablets and our laptops. It's important that we show them that there's a time to put these devices away and be fully present. It's also important to provide youth with app-enabled experiences that emphasize open-ended exploration and personal initiative over the more structured, top-down, constrained activities. So this is very much in a constructivist mindset of education. And this applies, by the way, both to online and offline experiences. It's also important to teach computational skills so that kids are able to modify existing apps and create their own apps so that they are in charge of their technology. And this is something I'm at the Information School at the University of Washington, and this is really a focus of ours in the informatics program, is helping young people to become designers and programmers of their own apps. And then finally, designers have a responsibility to at least consider in the design process whether their apps lean toward app enablement or app dependence. So of course, you never know exactly how your design is going to be used, and you don't fully have control over that. But we would at least hope that you think about this distinction between enablement and dependence during the design process and attempt to design so that users are encouraged to use their apps in more of an open-ended way and as non-constrained as possible. So to give you a bit of a sense of what a big impact educators and parents can have on kids' dispositions towards either app dependence or app enablement, consider this study that we came across during the course of our research for the book. And it was conducted by a psychologist named Liz Bonowitz. And it's actually nothing, it's not to do anything to do with apps, and it's actually nothing even to do with technology. But I think it really does show very powerfully the difference between teaching for app enablement versus teaching for app dependence. So in this experiment, it's very simple. Probably the hardest part of it was creating this contraption, but young children are brought into the lab, and they're presented with a very intricate, unfamiliar toy to them. And there's all sorts of things that you can do. You can squeak it, there's a light, there's music, there's a mirror, there's all sorts of stuff that you could do with this toy. Now, in one condition, half of the kids are randomly assigned to a condition where the adult researcher comes in and very carefully demonstrates exactly how the child should use this toy, how it works. In the other condition, the other half of the kids, again, the adult comes in and starts to show the child how it's supposed to be used, but then they're called away for some reason. And they leave the kid on their own to explore the toy and figure out how it works for themselves. So what they found was that when the children were given free rein to explore on their own, they engaged for a longer time with the toy, and they also came up with a broader range of ways to use the toy. So in that open-ended scenario, their play was actually of longer duration, and it was more interesting. It was more generative. But why does this even matter? Apps are fun, they're convenient, and they make life better, and I don't want to get rid of mine. So why should we even bother thinking about this app enablement versus app dependence and teaching towards the former? Well, I'd like you to consider this quote by the philosopher Alfred North Whitehead that we end the book with. And he says that civilization advances by extending the number of important operations which we can perform without thinking about them. Now, on the face of it, this sounds pretty great. And there are plenty of examples of apps that take care of mundane tasks so that we don't even have to think about them. So laundry and grocery shopping and other daily chores, hailing a cab. I use pretty much all of these things. And ostensibly, taking care of these mundane things is supposed to free us up to engage in more meaningful and fulfilling experiences. But the question is, and the question we should ask ourselves, is where does this outsourcing end? So consider the movie Her. Who here has seen the movie? Okay, so it looks like about half of the people here. Don't worry, I won't give anything away. Just the basic premise, and probably even if you haven't seen it, many of you are probably aware, it's about this main character, Theodore, and it's basically a love story between him and his operating system. He kind of falls in love with his operating system, who is intelligent. And you can't really blame him because her voice is narrated by Scarlett Johansson. But, you know, this is a love story. But in a bigger sense, this movie is about much more than a love story with a machine. It's about our relationship to technology and how that's affecting our existence in the world. And so I want to just relate to you a scene that really sticks with me. And it actually has nothing to do with the love story. It doesn't give anything away. It actually happens right at the start of the movie. And we see Theodore sitting at his desk in his cubicle, where he works. He works at a place called beautifulhandwrittenletters.com. And the camera starts to pan out from where he's sitting, and we start to see and we start to overhear the other workers, and they're dictating surrogate letters on behalf of grandchildren, thanking their grandparents for the birthday present, on behalf of spouses, wishing each other happy anniversary. And it just really struck me. And I wonder, is this where we're heading? How much of ourselves and our relationships are we willing to outsource? Are we prepared to outsource child rearing to apps and technology? Are we already doing it? Just consider that I did not make this up. There is actually a product being sold called an aptivity seat. You just plug in your tablet and the baby is entertained for hours, I guess. So we end the book on a very optimistic note, with a conversation between Howard and his then 6-year-old grandson, Oscar. And this really gives us hope that perhaps members of the app generation will find their way towards app enablement. And I'll just read from the very final part of this conversation. So as the book was just about finished, Howard had the opportunity to talk with his grandson, Oscar, about his experiences with digital media. Except for Howard's checking with Oscar's parents beforehand, Oscar was not prepared or prompted in any way for the chat. He allowed Howard to record the conversation, and actually when the interview was concluded, he showed Howard how to shut off the recording function on his iPhone. And not surprisingly, as a child in 2005, Oscar has always been surrounded by digital media. He is completely conversant and comfortable with the terminology and jargon. So Howard asked him, what would happen if Opa, which is what Oscar calls his grandfather, took away his iPhone? Oscar says, I would not be sad. I still have a computer. And Howard says, what do you do on it? Oscar answers, search on toys, go to .com, to do something like herofactory.com, little things. I can write a little code into the line so I can play some sort of game. Howard was a bit taken aback at Oscar's ease with terminology like .com and activities like write a little code. And so Howard asked him if he ever Googled anything. The following exchange ensued. Oscar said, I Google everything. Amazon, like anything I need to go to Google or write it down. Howard says, you sound a bit exasperated. Oscar says, kind of, but I'm not sure I know what exasperated means. Howard moved to next, what one does and what one does not do with computers. Here, Oscar made a very clear distinction. Howard asked, he said, I grew up without computers. What do you think that was like? Oscar says, people would do all chores and more chores and more chores and no fun. Howard says, no fun? Oscar, a little bit, but not much fun. Howard says, do you use computers for school and study? Oscar says, I don't really do those things. I mean, he's only 6, after all. I just use my computers for fun. Howard asks, how do your mom and dad use computers? Oscar, for only one thing, work. My mom downloads things that she has to do, like does work about food in my school. His mother was doing graduate work at the time in food science. So it appears then that Oscar makes a rather sharp division. Kids, computers, fun versus adults, no computer, no fun, or adults, computers, work. But were computers merely a source of pleasure and amusement? So Howard decided to push Oscar a bit on what digital media did and did not mean to him, and what they enabled or prevented. So this conversation proved most illuminating with respect particularly to how Oscar sees the world, in other words, his digital worldview. So Howard asked, how do you feel when your parents say, put it away? Oscar said, I feel a little blue. A little blue, said in a slightly plaintive tone. Howard asks, how would you feel if your parents took all your computers and phones away for a few weeks? Oscar says, I'd feel a little blue, but I could actually have a little more freedom. Play with my toys, play with Aggie, his then 8-month-old sister, go to places with mom and dad. Howard said, what do you mean by freedom? Oscar, mostly people have technology, his word, no prompting from his grandfather. They are watching every game and makes a boring sound and do it all day and don't do anything else but just watch TV. So without technology, you can play with toys and things like that. Now, Oscar, at the age of 6, is certainly not a student of digital media, nor has he read about utopias and dystopias. Yet, at age 6, he already senses that one can become a prisoner of the new technologies and that a world beyond them is beckoning to be explored, if there were just time and space to do so. He has figured out that there is virtue and even reward in figuring out things for yourself on your own time and in your own way. And I will conclude there. Thank you. Yes.
So when you looked at creativity and imagination, you charted how teens possibly changed from the 90s to the current day. But did you also look at the subtext for how those media have been changing? How are the established people in that media adapting, right? They haven't stood still in the past few decades. Were the teens merely reflecting what they're seeing the established media doing? Or is it really technology that's driving a change in their patterns there?
Well, you know what? So we cannot say that these changes have been or have not been caused by technology. We can do our best to just look at the changes and then look at what's been changing in society at the same time. And that's why actually in the book we talk quite extensively about other societal changes. And really an important one, I think, is just the way kids are being taught in schools. And that's really changed a lot over the last 20 years. And I think it's had an effect. And we've spoken with a lot of teachers who have said they feel constrained in the way they teach. But with respect, so I think that with the writing, I suspect that what we're seeing is really probably more a reflection of the education system and how that has changed. Though I think the change in the language probably has to do with just conventions of discourse online. With respect to the visual art, I think we've had a lot of conversations about what is this? Because we see that the more recent pieces are more interesting, frankly. They're more complex, they're less conventional. So what accounts for that change? Are they being taught in a different way? Is it the digital tools that give them the ability to create in that new way? Or some of on our research team have suggested that perhaps it could actually be that they're being exposed to others' creations, and they're actually just mimicking what they're seeing online. It's hard to know, you know, without a controlled experiment, and you know, you can't really do a controlled experiment under these conditions. But I do think that the element, I didn't mention it originally, but I do think the element of being affected by what you're seeing other people produce probably has a role. Now, I think the question then is, okay, is that a nice scaffold for kids to start, and then they can kind of produce beyond that and push the boundaries beyond that? Or are they just going to stay there at that point of just repeating what they see? And that's, I think, an open question. Yes.
In all your presentation, you didn't distinguish about gender, but I'm wondering if there is, in any of these topics that you have investigated, any significant difference.
So with the art, we didn't see. Oh, sorry, sure. So I didn't say anything about gender and differences between boys and girls that we saw. And so with respect to the creative productions, we did not see any noticeable differences. And we could see, we did have gender data. We also did have age data, and we didn't really see any differences there. I didn't actually talk at all about one of the other focuses of my research, which is bullying, and just not just bullying, but just kind of hate speech and teasing and stuff. In my conversations with teens, it's definitely the girls who talk about that the most, and then the boys who are saying, oh, that's what girls do. You know, they get into all these fights online and things like that. They may not call it bullying. But you know, the younger kids do call it bullying, age 10 and 11, but the older ones don't. And so there I did see a difference. With identity exploration, girls, there was both. You know, both boys and girls were open to going online to explore different identities. But actually, I think this is probably in... What stood out to me as the biggest difference was actually in the interview process itself. If you look at the interview transcripts with the girls, it's much longer than the interview transcripts with the boys. They just didn't say as much. But there was still, you know, they're both still using these technologies to connect with other people. I think the intensity of those personal text messages and IMs between friends, that kind of seems to peak in early adolescence among girls in particular. And that is very much reflective of developmental literature because it shows that in early teenage years, particularly with girls, there's a lot of, you know, self-divulgence and really trying to explore who you are in the context of your close friendships.
Yes. Yeah, I'm from a teacher perspective, I'm kind of curious what you think about skill development, because when we first heard about calculators, which is really the first app, right, about not being able to add and subtract, and I don't know if you saw recently Microsoft and Skype about foreign language now, there's really, if Skype can speak Italian for me, a German, well, why learn German? So from a teacher perspective, how about for the skill development? How's it going to impact skill development?
Well, those two examples I think are so interesting, and I have a different response to both those two. And because, so with if you think about calculators, I would say, and you know, with learning statistics as well, should you do, some professors still think you should do the math longhand. Some say that's just keep slowing you down from doing the answering the really interesting questions. And so I take that approach to calculators and things like that. You know, let that free you up and use those to free you up to so that you can answer big, meatier questions. But when it comes to learning a language, if you're going, and the, you know, I've thought a lot about, and I have a PhD student who's going to be doing some research soon on the experience of traveling now, when you actually can get by just fine not learning the language because you have an app to help you translate the language. And I remember, you know, spending my year abroad in France and just feeling completely lost, but then getting over it and, you know, learning the language. And I think I would hate to see that be lost. And I think that there is definitely merit in getting into your in a zone of being uncomfortable. And actually, it reminds me of something that Howard and I were so shocked by. So we had a series of conversations with my sister Molly, and she was 17 at the time. And in these conversations, we talked about our own histories growing up with the technologies of our time. And it came to light that Molly had never been lost before. And both Howard and I have experienced very vivid memories of being lost. I remember being lost trying to find my mother in the Long Island Railroad station and just not knowing what to do and just having to figure it out and draw my own resources. Whereas Molly has never had that experience. Now, she probably will one day when her phone, like the battery dies or something. And I had that experience last week, my phone battery died. But I just think it's such an interesting thing to think of. Yes?
So going on the theme of app enablement versus app, I would actually, my even goes as far as to say app disablement. Speaking to an audience like this, who's involved with technology, the production of technology, et cetera, what can this audience keep in mind, and what is the movement, if you will, or the direction towards helping Oscar not be swept along, right, by his peers or what he sees or the influences that he has, and steer him in that direction so he's not, so he can act on his intuitiveness that maybe I need to put the toys away or the technology away sometimes myself.
Yeah.
What do we do to help that?
Well, it's interesting. It makes me think, I'm not sure if you saw the same article that I did recently, but apparently parents in Silicon Valley, more than any other area, send their kids to Waldorf schools where there's no technology at all. I think that's really interesting and kind of telling. But it also suggests that there is a recognition that there needs to be some sort of balance, and I would say, as I mentioned before, that modeling is important. So with kids, anyone, parents, family, relatives can model that behavior, and provide experiences that use technology in an open-ended way, but also provide experiences that actually have nothing to do with technology at all. But then, when it comes to this particular crowd and designers of technology, one of my colleagues at the Information School, Batya Friedman, has a concept of value-sensitive design, where it's really important to think about human values in the design process, and really take those into account, because these technologies, while technology doesn't determine what we do, it does, the interaction between our technology and our social practices really shapes what we do in important fundamental ways. And so it's at the design point, I think, it is a really important time to think about that. Yes.
So you had said, in kind of looking at your research, that kind of earlier generations were shaped more by world events like World War II and so on, and then you have kind of this app generation. I was wondering, in kind of looking at maybe kids who grew up and remember 9/11 happening, and then kind of growing up in sort of like the specter of the shadow of terrorism, did you find any sort of like that was a shaping event for more kids versus the apps, or how
that interacted? It's amazing. It wasn't as much. And now, this is not our research. This was actually, this is research done by Arthur Levine at Princeton. And he's done a series of national surveys of college campuses since the 70s, like once every decade. And the most recent one, where the youth of now, they were, in kindergarten, high schoolers, I think, who are graduating, I think, might have been in kindergarten at 9/11. And so college kids have vivid memories of this. But what stands out to them when they're asked, what has been the most significant change in your lifetime, or event, not change, but event? More of them say technology. And actually, there was just a small survey that some reporters at the Kitsap, I think it's Tribune, I'm not sure, it's a newspaper, they called me last week because they told me that they had done this survey of the graduating seniors at the high school, and they also had said that the biggest event of their lifetime was the invention of the smartphone. And they asked them about 9/11 and all these things, and that was important, and the capturing of Osama bin Laden was very important, but there was no one thing that such a large proportion of them kind of focused in on as important as the smartphone, which it's amazing. Now, I don't know, will they still think that way when they're in their 30s and their 40s? Maybe that'll change. But yeah, it's not just us characterizing them in terms of technology, it's them as well. Yeah.
Do you think there is an opportunity to create a campground for people to get away from apps?
Like a camp?
Like a campground. Like you're away from highways and infrastructure, running water,
yeah,
electricity.
As long as the parents don't send their kids with two cell phones.
But this is for grown-ups.
Yeah, well, I think that those, I have friends who, they think about where they go on vacation now based on where there is no cell phone coverage. And I actually love it. I have family in Canada, and I don't make any effort to extend my cell phone plan when I'm in Canada. I just say, okay, it's off. There are people who are, you know, creating those spaces for themselves, and kids as well. And, you know, when I talk to youth, they are really ambivalent about technology. They can't imagine, probably like us now, can't imagine life without it. But they do definitely recognize just the pressure of always feeling they have to be responding to their friends and always reachable, especially during adolescence when, you know, your peer group is just, that's where you're developing. It's so important. And if you're not in it, you know, and if you're not reachable, that can have dire social consequences for you. But I do think that youth, you know, I see pockets of friends saying, okay, we're going to take a Facebook fast or something like that. We're just going to cut out and we're just going to be around each other. And I think that those kinds of self-corrections are great.
My question, again, next comes in monetization. Just as REI monetized the people's need to go to camps, is there a way to monetize people's need to go away from technology?
I'm sure there is, and I'm sure there are people who are... I bet that on websites where for, you know, rural wilderness type vacations, they probably feature that, you know, detached, you know, cut the cord from your technology.
Yes. So with your research and showing boys and girls all using technology, we've seen the decrease, unfortunately, of girls going into STEM-related fields. Any insight into how we could ignite that with the young girls?
Yeah, actually, there was just this was just featured research from UW yesterday, I think, on NPR or KUOW about one of the big challenges here is the social norms around computer programming and the perception that this researcher found of women, this perception that you know, it's the geeky guys who are computer programmers and they don't see themselves in that at all. And one of my areas of focus is identity development. And since this research, I'm focusing particularly on identity development in the context of education. How is it that young people come to see themselves as computer programmers versus writers versus whatever, actors? And it starts really early. And I think that, I think the interventions need to happen at many different stages. And it needs to start early at elementary school and even beyond and before that. And unfortunately, you know, if you think about what schools are responsible for testing, it's not computer programming, it's not computational thinking, it's English language arts and math, which clearly are very important, but the Common Core doesn't have computer programming. Now, hopefully that can change in the future, but I think it's really important. And then all the way through that, and then just changing social norms. Yes?
You looked at app enabling and app dependence. Do you look at kids' preferences towards one or the other? Do you see them a certain set of attributes for the kids that were gravitating towards one versus the other, or did you really see a difference?
Well, I think Howard and I might have slightly different answers to that. He tends to be more of a pessimist, and he saw app dependence in a lot more places than I felt that it was present. I think a lot of youth are, but I don't think it's the majority, are very good at being moderating themselves. I think most youth are kind of somewhere in the middle where some days they're tilting more towards dependence, some they're more towards enablement. But I think there are a smaller group that, and if there wasn't this technology, they'd be having a rough time anyway, connecting with people, figuring out who they are. And they're the ones who they tend to get themselves down a hole where they're just so, they get really into one thing online and it almost, they can't detach from that. And it's by no means the majority. And actually, that's why I think it's important to really flesh out and figure out which kids are and are not showing these signs, and which kids are doing great and under what circumstances, and being a little bit more specific rather than all kids are doing this or all kids are doing that.
One more question.
Okay. Yes.
Hi. I wanted to follow up on your comments about cyberbullying in particular. And I'm wondering if you have any data about, you know, the ubiquity of the device creates sort of a lack of a safe haven for cyberbullying, and what, how youth experience that, and then tangentially to that, how youth experience sort of premature exposure to graphic violence or adult content or any of the other sort of darker parts of the app world.
Yeah, so with the cyberbullying, so that constant always being connected to your device, that really does. And, you know, there's a fine line between bullying and then just always communicating with your friends. That in itself can feel kind of suffocating, even when there's no bullying going on. Just the feeling that you have to always be answering either your you know, your boyfriend or your girlfriend or your best friend. But then the real bullying, when that happens 24/7, that can really, I mean, just offline bullying is hard enough, but at least it happens and then it stops and it may happen again, but you know, at least sometimes you can have a space away from that. In one of my larger quantitative studies, I looked at some predictors of cyberbullying, and one of them was the amount of time that kids spend on their cell phones, the amount of time they spend on Facebook. This was in 2010, so Facebook was still very popular. Those were predictors of experiences of bullying, although I didn't call it bullying because that doesn't really resonate with teens. I was very specific about specific experiences they had online. On the more hopeful side, some buffers, so things that would predict a decrease in bullying in that study were actually things that we might control. So things like kids who had closer relationships to either their mother or their father were less likely to experience cyberbullying. And also the biggest predictor was kids who felt like they had at least one person at school who they could trust, and they had positive experiences, and usually like an adult at school, and just good experiences at school really seemed to be a buffer against bullying. So I think it really does suggest that there is a place for adults to really have a positive effect and support kids. I think sometimes adults and teachers and parents, they're the ones I speak with the most, feel like, well, you know, the kids know way more than I do, so, you know, why should I have nothing to give them. I have nothing to add. But they do, and they may not know as much. Often they do, though. Even if they don't know as much technically, they still have, you know, a lot of life experience to impart and just emotional support to give. And I think that's really important. And your second part had to do with the violent content and the adult content. That's less of my focus, but it's definitely. I think that's a real concern, and I think there's a real tension there between wanting to protect kids, especially younger kids. I think once you start to get into the mid-teen years and above, they can mostly handle it. Although what does concern me is, you know, how women are treated sometimes online, and the misogyny that you can see online, and online porn and things like that, and what messages that sends to young boys about what is okay and how it's okay to interact and treat women. That is concerning to me, but I haven't looked at it specifically. But with younger kids, I think that's, you know, they don't really know how to interpret that. They interpret the world very concretely, and so it's very confusing. But I do think there's a tension between wanting to protect kids from that on the one hand, and then blocking everything and blocking their access to a lot of really rich experiences online. And also, you know, issues of trust. You know, if your parent is monitoring you 24/7 and see looking at your phone log and things like that, that's hard to develop and maintain trust in that situation. So I think it's a really tricky area for parents to navigate. And I don't think we're all trying to figure it out right now, unfortunately.
Katie, thank you so much for coming.
Thank you so much for having me.